All right. Yeah, that's actually the first time I've ever been asked to have entrance music. They asked me to give them entrance music. So, I mean, it's not Eye of the Tiger, it's like Cocktails for Two, which tells you a little bit about myself. So, my name is Robert Simonson. I'm from New York. I write about cocktails for a living. I've been doing that since about 2006. So it's a good chunk of time, 13 or 14 years. And I took a lot of what I learned and I put it into a book called A Proper Drink, which was published in 2016, which was the first history of the cocktail revival. And I wrote it down as best as I could. It's a book that's about 300 pages long. It's really hard to encapsulate that kind of thing in a presentation like this. And so I decided to do it in pictures. So I'm going to show you 40 pictures in a row, and each one sort of captures a particular moment in time when the cocktail revival turned a little corner or did something important. It's a lot of information, so we'll see if I can get through it in an hour. I've done it before. I think I'll do it again. So we'll just start right away. So this is 1977. The man in that picture is a man named Dick Bradsell. Dick Bradsell was the godfather of the London cocktail revival. He was born on the Isle of Wight. He was kind of a directionless youth. He was a bit of a rebel. He liked to party. He trashed his family's house a couple times. So they were happy when he left around the age of 18. He went to London and he got a job as a bartender. His family got him a job at a military club. And he found that he liked bartending. But more than that, he found that he was interested in it. He respected the profession. He was interested in the history of cocktails. So he started educating himself. And he ended up working in some private clubs like Fred's Club, Zanzibar. This is Zanzibar right here. He's a very young man at this point. And he ended up being very influential. He had a lot of proteges. He taught a lot of the bartenders who created the London cocktail scene. And he also became a writer and he wrote for various magazines. So his arrival in London was very significant. And here we are in 1982, now we're in Germany. This is Munich, Germany, and that's Charles Schumann. Charles Schumann founded a bar in Munich in 1982 called Schumann's Bar. And he sort of performed the same role that Dick Bradsell did in London. Only it was more widespread. Back then, there weren't a lot of freestanding cocktail bars in Europe, places that weren't attached to restaurants, places that just served cocktails, classic cocktails. But he did that, and a lot of people were influenced by him. He also started writing cocktail books, like the American Bar Book, and nobody was writing cocktail books at that point. And that was the first book that many young bartenders found when they started getting interested in cocktails. That bar is still open. I'm sure many of you have been there. Here we are, still in 1982, but now we are in London. And this is Thomas Estes. He was from California. He was a teacher, but he didn't like that. He had some wanderlust, so he went to Europe. And he opened a bar called the Café Pacifico in Amsterdam. And then he opened another one in London. And the reason why it was important was it was a Mexican restaurant. And he took tequila very seriously. He had a good selection of tequila, and he made margaritas with fresh lime juice, which was unusual at the time. And most English bartenders did not know much about tequila at the time. And so it became a mecca for these bartenders who wanted to learn more about what they were serving. And so they went to the Cafe Pacifico and had these wonderful margaritas. He continued to be this kind of apostle of agave spirits, and he actually formed his own brand of tequila. He's still at it. This is a man named Jörg Rupf. He was from Alsace, and then he went to California, where he was put in charge of a distillery called St. George Spirits. Now, this was important because this was virtually the first craft distillery of the United States. And And a lot of people took a page from him. Now we have hundreds of craft distilleries, but when he started making eau de vie in California, nobody was doing that kind of thing. Everything was very produced on a very industrial scale. So he was a great forebearer. This is a man named Brother Cleave. He's from Boston. He's a musician, as you can see. He usually plays bass, but he's playing the accordion in this picture. He was in a lot of bands in the 80s and 90s, like the Del Fuegos and Combustible Edison. And when he was in the bands, he would travel all around the United States. And he would always go to these old restaurants, restaurants that still serve craft, that still serve old-style cocktails. And in 1985, he told me, he went to this place called Shorty's Diner in Cleveland, Ohio. And they had this long list of cocktails. And he looked at it and he goes, what the hell is a sidecar? And so he decided he wanted to find out. So he started collecting old cocktail books. He started looking for old cocktail ingredients so he could recreate all these cocktails that had been lost to time. And he pretty much is the godfather of the Boston cocktail revival as it grew up there. And he taught all the great Boston bartenders. I'm sure you know this guy. This is Dale DeGroff, probably the most famous bartender in the world. Here he is at the Rainbow Room. The Rainbow Room was a very swanky place in New York. But it had been closed for a while when it reopened in 1987. Dale DeGroff was an actor, and like many actors, he spent his time as a bartender until he got his big break. But he was hired by this restaurateur named Joe Baum, who said, I'm opening the Rainbow Room, and I wanted to have a bar that serves all the classic cocktails from pre-Prohibition. And so he went out and he taught himself. He got Jerry Thomas's old cocktail manual. And when the Rainbow Room opened, they had French 75s and Ramos Gin Fizzes and Sazeracs and all these drinks that New Yorkers had not seen in a generation. And he really kicked off the cocktail revival that way in the United States. This is a man named Toby Cicchini, who invented, for better or worse, the Cosmopolitan. He was a writer from Wisconsin. He moved to New York. And while he was trying to be a writer, he got a job as a bartender at the Odeon, which is a famous restaurant in New York. You probably maybe know it from Bright Lights, Big City, the novel. He invented the Cosmopolitan there in 1988 as a kind of a drink for the staff to have at the end of the shift. But it became popular with the patrons. And in quick time, it became a rather famous and well-known cocktail in New York and elsewhere. The reason I put this here, the Cosmopolitan, I feel, is an important drink because it sort of formed a link between the craft, between the old style cocktails of the past and the craft cocktail revolution of the 21st century. It showed that people could still be interested in cocktails and that you could create a drink that could become a household word. He now owns a bar in Brooklyn called Long Island Bar. If you're ever in Brooklyn, go there. The Cosmopolitan's not on the menu, but he will make one for you. This is Julio Bermejo. He owns a restaurant called Tommy's Mexican Restaurant in San Francisco. Julio did not want to work in the family restaurant. He wanted to become a diplomat, but that did not work out. So he went back to the restaurant, and he worked behind the bar because he wanted to basically hide there. But then he got interested in all the tequilas that they were carrying, and he's decided to make the program better and bring in better tequilas, 100% agave tequilas. And he also changed the way they served margaritas. So he invented something called the Tommy's Margarita, which I'm sure a lot of you have had. The Tommy's Margarita has no curacao. It has agave syrup instead of sugar and has fresh lime juice. He did this because he wanted to showcase the flavors of tequila and show people that it could be a serious spirit. And in that way, he helped turn around the tides of tequila, started to make it a more respected spirit in the United States. Here's Ted Hay. Ted, are you in the audience? Hey, Ted Hay. You'll have to forgive my description of your history as I'm about to give it. He was an itinerant ne'er-do-well who sort of finally fell into the area of graphic design for movies, correct? Yes, right. And so in this job, he would travel around the United States. And he had this side interest in craft cocktails and old-style pre-prohibition cocktails. He had all these recipe books. But the problem was you couldn't get the ingredients to make these drinks anymore. A lot of these ingredients had gone out of production. And so whenever he was at a movie set in wherever, Charlotte or Chicago or Denver or whatever, he would find the oldest liquor store and look for the old ingredients, and then he would bring them home and recreate the cocktails in his home. And he put together this knowledge that he had accrued into a book that he published in 2004. 2004? When did your book come from? 2003. Which was really one of the first books of its kind. Basically, in a nutshell, Ted Hay invented the job of cocktail historian. He was the first cocktail historian. So, all right. Yes, and we thank him. I wouldn't have a job without him. This is Ted Bro. Ted Bro is basically single-handedly responsible for bringing back absinthe to the United States. Absinthe was banned in the United States. It was thought to be, it would create hallucinations and be detrimental to your health. It was banned in 1912, and so that sort of eliminated a lot of cocktails that you could make in their original form. Ted was a biochemist. He worked for a petroleum company in Louisiana, and so he became obsessed with absinthe, and he decided to take it upon himself to figure out if all these accusations, all these things they said about absinthe were true or not. And he basically found out they were not true, and through his findings and his tests, he was able to convince, he was instrumental in convincing the U.S. government to overturn the ban. And so that was in 2007, and then absinthe was brought back into the country, and so we could make Sazeracs, we could make absinthe fraps, we could make any kind of thing. So very important man there. All right, this is a man named William Grimes. He is a journalist at the New York Times, and back in the late 80s and early 90s, he was basically the only serious journalist writing about cocktails in the United States. And somebody approached him, a publisher said, do you want to just write a book about this? And he said, well, the only way I can think about writing this book is to write the whole thing, the whole history of cocktails in the United States. And so he wrote Straight Up and On the Rocks, and he did us all a great service because he told us the history of the cocktail, which a lot of people had forgotten, and it was a 200-year-old history, and he laid it down there in print. It did not get a lot of attention when it was published, but it became a great tool for a lot of us as the cocktail revival gathered energy. This is Angel's Share. This is a bar in New York City, one of the earliest, perhaps the earliest craft cocktail bar in New York City. It is a Japanese-style bar. It is on the second floor above a sushi restaurant. The owner wanted to create a bar, the kind of bars that he remembered from Tokyo. And so he created this very hushed atmosphere. It was secret. You had to know where the entrance was. You could only be a party of four or smaller. There was no standing. There was decorum. You couldn't talk loudly. And it became very influential because it influenced a man we're going to see later, Sasha Petrasky, who basically took the model and created the most famous bar in the world, Milk and Honey. Angel's Share is still open. Okay, this is the Atlantic Bar and Grill. The man in the mermaid costume is Oliver Payton. this is a very instrumental bar in London history. Back in 1994, if you wanted to drink, you either went to a pub, or you went to a private club, or you went to hotel bars, which were kind of boring, or you went to illegal drinking dens. Atlantic Bar and Grill, which is right in the middle of Soho, had long hours. It was open until like 4 a.m. Anyone could go if you were willing to stand in line. And also, it made cocktails a spotlight. Oliver Payton hired Dick Bradsell, if you remember him from the first slide, and gave him his own bar, calling it Dick's Bar. And this really kind of like put cocktails on the map. And a lot of people point to the Atlantic Bar and Grill as the real beginning of the cocktail renaissance in London. Strange, it's such a famous place, but there are almost no photos of it. I got this photo from Oliver Payton himself. It's the only one he could find. And he's dressed like that. Right. And here we are with Ron Cooper talking to some mezcaleros down in Mexico. Ron Cooper, who you probably know from the Del Maguey brand of mezcal, he was an artist in California. And he liked to go to Mexico. And he went all the time. And when he went down there, he fell in love with mezcal. And then he started to visit the small distilleries where the mezcal was made and got to know the people who made it. He made it his mission to get mezcal better known in the United States. It was very misunderstood at that point. And slowly but surely, he educated the country. Then he started to bring in the brands, the Del Maguey brands that he helped to create with these mezcaleros. I'm sure that Del Maguey may be like the first mezcal brand that many people have tried. He really kind of single-handedly turned the tide and changed the reputation of mezcal in the United States and elsewhere, and also helped get it into the cocktail world. All right, this is a bar named Pravda. It was in Soho in New York. It's no longer there. It was run by a man named Keith McNally, who's a famous restaurateur with restaurants in London and New York. The reason I put this up here, it was a vodka bar, but Keith McNally was one of the first restaurateurs to take the cocktail revival seriously in the United States. For a long time, the restaurateurs saw the bar as, well, it was just a source of cash. It bring in cash to feed the restaurant, and they didn't like it when the bartenders got attention, as much attention as the chef, and so there was this kind of war going on. But Keith McNally realized, no, this cocktail thing can help me, and my restaurants should have good cocktails. That should be part of a good restaurant. And so he was one of the first people to do that and act differently that way. Can I go back? Those guys there, they went on to open Employees Only, a bar in New York. Okay, Class Magazine. So this is a magazine that was started in London in 1997 by a man named Simon Difford. And it provided a great role in that it helped. There was this bartending community that was coming together, but they needed information to share. And so this was a magazine that they could all read, see what the other people were doing, get ideas for their bars. After this, there were soon magazines like it in Germany and Australia. So an influential publication. This is a book called Cocktail, which was published in 1998 by a man named Paul Harrington. Now you have to remember that people didn't really publish cocktail books in the 70s and 80s and 90s so much. People weren't interested, at least not in serious cocktails or in cocktail history. So what Paul Harrington did in collaboration with Wired Magazine, where he wrote a column, is he put all these classic cocktails into one book, and with each cocktail he put a page of history telling, you know, where that cocktail came from and its supposed origins. This cocktail book fell into the hands of a lot of bartenders across the world and influenced them as they were trying to rediscover the cocktail world and mixology. That man there is Robert Hess. And Robert Hess is an IT guy. He works for Microsoft, but he had an interest in cocktails. A lot of the influential people in the early days of the cocktail revival were laymen, you know, people who did something else for a living, but had this passion, this side passion for cocktails. Now, he liked making cocktails, but he was sometimes frustrated. He didn't know how to make them correctly. He didn't have the information. He didn't have the books. And so what he did was what any tech geek would do, was he created an online platform. He created a website called, a chat room called Drink Boy. And Drink Boy became very important because, like, if you were a cocktail geek or a cocktail enthusiast, you went to Drink Boy and there you discussed, you know, the best recipe for the old fashioned or where you think the Manhattan was invented. And that's how a lot of these early arguments in the revival were hashed out on sites like Drink Boy, as well as Ted Hayes' America Online, which was really probably the first one. You're the head of that cocktail page. Yeah, I meant to mention that. 1998. Now we're in San Francisco. This is a bar called Absinthe. It's still there. Pretty much, in my opinion, the three capitals in the early years of the cocktail revival were New York, London, and San Francisco. A lot of people think Absinthe was the first important cocktail bar in San Francisco. The cocktail program was run by a guy named Marco Dionysus. And he had a very innovative menu. He not only listed the drink, but he listed the book where he got the drink, like a book from 1902, and the history of the drink. So the menu was a history lesson, and you were learning while you were drinking. This is obviously something that's common today, but it wasn't back then. This man is Jeff Barry. He almost single-handedly rescued tiki drink culture from the dustbin of history. Again, a man who had a different job. He was also in the movies. He did a little directing. He wrote advertising copy for the movies. But in his spare time, he would go to the old tiki bars in Los Angeles, often with Ted Hay, and he'd try to get the recipes from the old bartenders, because the problem with tiki culture was that all the recipes were secret. Don the Beachcomber did not want Trader Vic to steal his recipes and vice versa. So what happens then is that all the recipes disappear. And so bit by bit, Jeff found all the old recipes, and in 1988, he started publishing them. His first book was published by a comic book publisher called Slave Labor. After that, it was published by other people, but he's written many books by now. But if you have enjoyed good tiki drinks in a tiki bar anywhere, here in Kiev or elsewhere, you can thank him. All right. This is a bar in Melbourne called, am I blanking on this? Just one second, looking at notes. The Gin Palace, and that flamboyant gentleman is Vernon Chalker. The story in Australia was different. A lot of things what kept Australia back in terms of good drinking were the laws. They had laws that made it very hard to open a good bar. But in 1998, there was a law that was passed. It was sort of the byproduct of this big casino wanted to come into town. So Melbourne wanted the big casino to come in. So in order to do that, they changed the laws, making it easier, basically, for everyone to open small bars in Melbourne. And so that's what started to happen. And one of the first of them was Gin Palace, which was a bar dedicated to gin, which was unheard of at the time. Nobody cared about gin. Now Melbourne is, of course, a great cocktail capital. Next. 1999, that is Sasha Petrasky. He is the most important figure in the history of the cocktail renaissance. He is the man who opened Milk and Honey. He's from New York City. He wanted to open a cafe. He was interested in fine coffee, but that didn't work out. So instead, he decided to open a cocktail bar. And he was a very serious-minded man, and so he wanted to do things in a dignified way. He didn't like the noisy bars that were the norm in New York City at the time. So he created this little hidden place on the Lower East Side. It didn't have a name on the door. It didn't have a phone number. When you went in, they played jazz music. There was no menu. You had to have a conversation with the bartender, and then you'd figure out what you want to drink. And he served these elegant craft cocktails. He was slow to learn. It took a year or two till he really got on his feet. But people noticed that he was doing something different immediately, and people sought him out. Milk and Honey has probably influenced more bars than any other bar of the last 25 years. In every city you go, there's a bar that is obviously modeled on Milk and Honey. It unfortunately no longer exists, and sadly, Sasha passed away in 2015. This is a piece of ice. So we're back with Sasha Petrasky. A lot of the innovations that Sasha Petrasky came up with at Milk and Honey were because of expedience's sake. he couldn't fit an ice maker behind his tiny bar. So he had to find a way to bring ice to his bar. So what he started to do was freeze water in large flat trays, and then he would carve it up into cubes and spears. People were amazed by this because they had never seen such beautiful ice. All the ice that we had back then was just crappy, thin, watery ice that you got from an ice maker. And when people saw this, everyone started copying it. So there you have the roots of the craft ice that we see everywhere in the world today. This is Ann Tuneman. At the time, she was Ann Rogers. She is the founder of Tales of the Cocktail, which is a cocktail convention in New Orleans that was founded in 2002. The whole idea of a cocktail convention at the time was rather absurd. Whoever heard of such a thing? But she thought, you know, she loved New Orleans and she loved cocktails, and she thought they were things worth celebrating. It only took a few years before everyone understood that, like, if you were serious about cocktails and you wanted to meet other people who were serious about cocktails and talk to them and exchange ideas, this was the place you had to go. Tales of the Cocktail has spawned many other conventions around the world. It's still going on today. Ah, Simon Ford, another person who's in the audience. There he is right there. Simon Ford is a bartender from Britain who pretty much created the template for the modern day brand ambassador. Once upon a time, there was no such thing as a brand ambassador. That was not a word, that was not a job. But he was hired by Plymouth Gin as their brand ambassador by a marketing genius named Nick Blacknell. So Simon's job was to, Plymouth Gin was a heritage brand, but it wasn't really selling anymore. It was down to a very minimal output. And Simon's job was to bring it back and save it and go to America and make people care. But what was different about the way that he did things is that he wasn't like your typical liquor salesman, you know, come into a bar, say, you know, buy my gin and I'll give you a television set. You know, he decided to respect the bartenders. He taught them not just about Plymouth, but about gin. And he ended up taking them on trips to the Plymouth distillery. It was all about education. And so this is a model that was quickly observed and followed by other liquor brands and liquor conglomerates. And within a few years, there were many other brand ambassadors. And we still have brand ambassadors today. This is Greg Baum. Greg Baum was a man who was the son of a publishing magnate. And he got interested in old cocktail books. And because he had enough money to buy them, he bought them all. And he had this huge collection of cocktail books. And then he just thought, well, what do I do with these old cocktail books? Well, then there's this cocktail revival that's going on. And part of the problem with the cocktail revival is we did not have the books to consult. If I wanted to make an aviation cocktail, I didn't know how, because that book was out of print and I couldn't find the recipe and I didn't know anyone who owned that book. So what Greg started doing is he republished these books and created new versions of them so that anybody out there could buy the cocktail manuals of Jerry Thomas or Harry Johnson or whoever you want to name. And it just delivered all this information into the hands of bartenders in one fell swoop. Also 2003, we are in Seattle now. That is a guy named Murray Stenson, who's probably the most famous bartender in Seattle. He is the man who brought the Last Word cocktail back from the dead. Now why I've included him here is, what he did was he found the Last Word, this old cocktail, that nobody had ever heard of, nobody remembered, and he put it on his menu at the Zigzag Cafe in Seattle, and it caught on. And then people started spreading the word, and it started being spread, you know, on the internet and things like that, and suddenly the Last Word within 2 years was served everywhere. And it was a lesson of how these cocktails that had been forgotten by time could be resurrected by cocktail bartenders. After the Last Word, there were many, many other examples of this kind of cocktail that was suddenly brought back from the dead. This is 2004. That man's name is Eric Seed. He lives in Minnesota. Eric Seed gave up his job in 2004 to start a small spirits importing business. He started bringing in some herbal liqueurs, you know, from Central Europe. Now, he also took a very different approach to his job. Instead of like having his whatever, his repertoire of bottles, going to bars and saying, do you want to buy in any of these? He would go to the bars and the bartenders, the cocktail bartenders, and say, what do you need? What do you want? What don't you have that I can get for you? And they would say, well, we want Batavia Arrack. We want Creme de Violette. We don't have these things. Can you get them for us? And he would go over to Europe or wherever, or the Caribbean, and he'd find them. And he'd bring them. So many lost ingredients were brought back because of him. 2004, that is Sed Moses, who is the king of cocktails in Los Angeles. He was the son of an artist, Ed Moses, and he used to hang around with poet Charles Bukowski in bars. He had this really interesting mathematical mind when he was in high school. His teachers would take him to the track because he knew how to handicap the horses, that they'd make a lot of money. So he decided to use all these smarts and start buying up real estate in central LA and opening up cocktail bars. Everyone thought he was crazy because downtown LA was dead at the time, but he ended up giving a new lease on life to cocktail bars in LA. Half the bars you would go to in Los Angeles are run by his company. This is 2005. This is at Pegu Club. I would say, I would argue, after Milk and Honey in New York, Pegu Club was the most important cocktail bar opening. The reason it was important was because Milk and Honey educated New York people on craft cocktails and how to drink them, how to respect them, how to understand them. By the time we got to 2005, there was a growing audience of cocktail enthusiasts, and they had this information, but they wanted to go to a place, you know, where they could deploy this information. So Audrey Saunders, on the right there, she hired all the best cocktail bars in the city. So this is sort of like, you know, when we reached the point where there was an actual audience and thirst for craft cocktails in New York City, and Pegu Club answered that thirst. 2005 was also the year that Regan's Orange Bitters were invented. It's hard to believe now, but once upon a time, there were no orange bitters in the world and you could not find them, which meant that you couldn't make certain cocktails. Gary Regan was a former bartender. He's a writer and historian. And he was frustrated with the situation himself, so he started experimenting, making batches of orange bitters at home until he got to a recipe that he liked. And then he went into a partnership with the Sazerac company, and they started producing the bitters. And so this was the first of many orange bitters. After this, there was a flood of bitters. Once there had only been Angostura and Peychaud's, and suddenly there were dozens and dozens of bitters, and it hasn't stopped yet. 2007 is when this book came out, Imbibe. If you're serious about bartending and cocktail history, I'm sure you have this book. It's written by David Wondrich, who is the preeminent cocktail historian of our day. And what he did was he tried to put together in one book, not just the biography of Jerry Thomas, who is thought to be the father of modern mixology in the United States, but also miniature biographies of all the famous cocktails, where they came from, what their histories might be, how to properly make them. He basically took a kind of sort of professorial attitude towards the whole subject. And so this is like the one textbook on cocktails you have to have. 2007, again, we're back in Australia. This is the Baxter Inn in Sydney. The problem with bars in Sydney were liquor licenses were very expensive. So unless you were a big restaurant corporation, you couldn't open a bar. But then they changed the law and they created the so-called small bar law. And so smaller bars like this could open in Sydney suddenly. So suddenly Sydney had a lot of cocktail bars, whereas before they had had none. And then they were able to compete with Melbourne. 2008, this is the Connaught Bar in London. Hotel bars were their own category. In many ways, hotel bars kept the cocktails alive for many years, but the hotel bars were also kind of musty, kind of boring, not very exciting, not a place where young people would go to drink. That started to change in London in 2008. The Connaught Bar and the Connaught Hotel in Mayfair was one of the first. They took cocktails seriously. They hired some hotshot bartenders to run it, including Ego Peroni, pictured here. And after that, all the cocktail bars in London started to renovate and make themselves better. That was followed by the same pattern in the United States and all over the world, so that you didn't necessarily have to go to some hidden cocktail speakeasy to get a good cocktail. You might be able to get one in your own hotel. Again, we're back to David Wondrich. He wrote a second book called Punch, all about punch. And this helped to bring back the beverage of punch, which had sort of gone away. People went and served punch in bars, and they rarely made it at home. And because of this book, you see punch a lot on cocktail menus all over the world. This is a bar called Mother's Ruin. I use it as representing the movement towards a casual cocktail bar. All the early important cocktail bars were rather formal. The bartenders wore vests and arm garters. It was quiet. You were not supposed to shout. They were trying to bring back dignity to their profession and to cocktail culture. And so it was understandable. But after a while, people just wanted to loosen up a bit. And so they thought, well, we can have cocktails, good cocktails, but it can still be fun. It can still be casual. Mother's Ruin in New York was one of the first people to do that. Now there are many, many casual cocktail bars everywhere you go. These women are Lynette Marrero and Ivy Mix. They founded an organization called Speed Rack. What Speed Rack does is it stages cocktail competitions throughout the world, and the competitors are all women, and the proceeds benefit breast cancer research. It was a very important exercise because up until then, there hadn't been a lot of attention given to women bartenders and the women in the industry. And through this, I mean, they have shone a spotlight on all sorts of women bartenders and helped give them a boost in the industry. 2011, this is the 50s World Best Bars. That's when this was started by an organization in London called Drinks International. At this point, the whole cocktail industry was big business. There was a lot of money to be made. And wherever money is to be made and wherever there is big business, award ceremonies follow. And so within just a few years, this became an important occasion for good and bad. I mean, it brought a lot of attention to these bars. It was they get recognized, they get honored. But also with the 50 best bars and awards like it, the focus of many bars began to change, where things like business and public profile and fame and things like that sort of became more important than invention and creativity. So a controversial force in the industry. 2012, this is a bar called White Lion that opened in London. It was opened by a man named Ryan Chetty, who I'm sure many of you know. Very influential. It did not last long. I think it was open about 4 years, 5 years. But he introduced a lot of ideas that have caught on otherwise. Things like sustainability in bars. He sourced his own alcohol. He didn't necessarily use brands behind the bar. He tried to find his own stuff. He did a lot of batching, and so the cocktails were all ready and could be poured out. A lot of these innovations, some were well debated, they were controversial, but in the end, a lot of them caught on. And then finally, here are three women who founded in Chicago a couple years ago a convention called Chicago Style. Up until then, cocktail conventions had been primarily about like education, like we need to relearn how to make cocktails. We need to learn about spirits, the history of cocktails, lots of tasting rooms, lots of spirited dinners, dinners with alcohol and stuff like that. It was just celebrating and bringing back this culture. But certain other things were ignored, certain social issues. things like sexism within the industry, diversity within the industry, substance abuse and things like that. Nobody was addressing these things or doing seminars about these things. So when they started this in 2016, they decided that would be the focus. And since then, most KATO conventions you go to, a lot of the conversation, it brings in these more troubling social issues along with the other stuff that, you know, we all enjoy. Is that the last one? Okay, that is the last one, but that's great. Now, I just want to say a couple things. So I've given this presentation before, and then people have asked me, it's just like, what happened? You got to 2012, and then you jumped to 2016, and it's like, what happened between then? And I am trying to say here how this whole KATO Renaissance came together, who the people were, what the bars were that made it all happen. And I do believe that all those building blocks came in the last 30 years. And sort of, we had all the tools that we needed by 2010, basically. Since then, basically, the story of the KATO revival has been expansion. You know, more and more bars and more cities, more like KATO cultures in more countries and different places. And continuing the standard, making sure that what we have learned and what we have built does not fall by the wayside, does not dwindle or diminish. So it's mainly about status quo. There's only so much innovation and invention you can do. And like, but now we have what was lost. What was lost, you know, a long time ago, we have it back, and hopefully it'll stay here. One last thing, shameless plug. I have a new book out. It's called The Martini Cocktail. It came out last week. It's not available here, but I brought 12 copies with me, and they are in the store. If you're interested in the martini, they are there, and I'd be happy to sign them if you do get them. So that was a lot of information, and thank you very much. Woo!
Ladies and gentlemen, can I hear it for Robert Simonson? All right. What an amazing way to kick off Roots at Barometer 2019. As you've seen in the schedule, between each main talk here at the Star Stage, we have a half-hour break. So there's a food court outside where you can use your prepaid card and downstairs try all the bars. I'll see you in half an hour at 1:30 for the one and only Simon Ford. And then at 3 o'clock, if you're interested, come back and see myself talking about bartender journeys. But I'll see you in a little bit.